She's pledged to turn promises into progress and to make Rochester better than how she found it. Coming up right now, a Need to Know Rochester special on the woman of the hour, Mayor Lovely Warren.
Rochester's news magazine since 1997. This is Need to Know Rochester.
Hello and Happy New Year. I'm Helen B. and Duty Hofer. Thanks for joining me for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. From flying to Washington, D.C. to meet with President Barack Obama, to traveling throughout local city neighborhoods to survey the challenges and the needs of our community, new Mayor Lovely Warren has been running nonstop since her election victory. And she's already experienced a number of highs and lows. Just a day after her inauguration, Warren's grandfather, Cecil McClary, died at the age of 87. Warren has said he was a motivating force for her getting into politics. I recently sat down with Mayor Lovely Warren to talk all about her new job and her plans for reviving Rochester. But first, we'll take you inside her home and introduce you to those she treasures most in life.
To the new mayor, we're excited to see you. Excited to see you in Albany.
I want to thank all the dignitaries that are here.
Lovely Warren is no stranger to political appearances, press conferences, and rubbing elbows with state and national leaders. It all started during her days as city council president. But once she made headlines as the first female African-American mayor of Rochester, the media interest and curiosity skyrocketed. The irony of it all is that she prefers to be out of the spotlight and right here. At home with her family.
All right. I'm a homebody that, you know, I don't, you know, maybe going to the mall once in a while, but really I find just peace being with my family. We have game night, you know, we play Cranium or Crazy Eight or Crazy Nines. We have people stopping by all the time and, you know, cooking, baking, reading books, and just really spending time with each other.
Being mayor is just one of the many hats worn by Warren. She's also an attorney, a wife, daughter, friend, and a mother. The last of which is her favorite role.
Do you want to come? Do you want to sit and watch?
Can you take that out of your mouth? Can you take that out of your mouth? Thank you. I see you went upstairs and got your own ponytail holder, right?
She loves the color. She's really a girly girl, so she's three. She's in the lip gloss and painting nails. She woke my mom up this morning wanting to paint her nails.
When asked if her daughter Taylor is more like mom or dad, Warren doesn't hesitate with her response.
She has the best of both of us and the worst of me.
So what's that like?
She's very independent, and so it takes some getting used to. She wants to do it her way, you know, so it's good.
In her role as a mother, Warren says she struggles to find balance between being protective and also giving Taylor the freedom to navigate the world on her own.
She goes to the Montessori school, so that independent type of thinking, doing it on your own, is something that they really encourage, but it's also something that, you know, just I believe in, to be able to touch and feel and to, you know, explore the world, because they're seeing it, some, you know, for the first time.
When she went to college and through high school, she was never a follower.
Warren's mother, Elrita Tisdale, says when her daughter was young, she was also an independent thinker and a leader.
She would always assist the other kids. So being in the house and growing up with her, I really didn't see her as mayor, but I certainly had the vision that she would do something remarkable.
I give her a little bit of this, a little bit of that, but I think she'll be fine. You know, like at first, you know, she's an attorney first, so it's like you can't out-talk an attorney.
As some might say, behind every strong leader is a supportive partner. Timothy Granison is Warren's husband. They met at a country suite restaurant years ago.
Her sister was in line, actually, when she was coming in to see what's taking her sister so long, and it was from there. And I was just telling her, you had to have patience, you know. Instead of her coming in and rushing her, you had to have patience. So it was funny how we met.
Turns out patience is something Granison is now asking the people of Rochester to have with his wife.
A lot of people, even to this day, they say they don't know anything about her, but, you know, she's been around for a while. It's just a lot of people that don't know who she is. It's just that they have to give her a chance and believe in her, you know, like I do.
Warren says it's the support of her family, longtime mentors, including Assemblyman David Gant, and even the support of President Barack Obama that will help her in her quest to revive this once thriving city. Warren was invited to the White House to meet with the president in December, along with other newly elected mayors. When asked if her new position would ever lead her to pursue the presidential seat, Warren laughed.
Oh, no. No. I'm comfortable where I'm at.
So you're comfortable where you are?
I'm comfortable here. We have some great work to do in the city of Rochester, and we'll definitely leave it better than we found it.
And now my studio interview with Mayor Lovely Warren. Lovely, for your mayoral campaign, the theme was believe. And I want to know, you know, now that you're mayor, how does that theme translate into your work and the things that you plan to tackle, the things that you've identified as your priorities as mayor, you know, education, crime, and economic development?
Well, it's everything, because we have so many challenges that are before us as a city. And so we have to believe that we can be better and we can do better. And that starts, you know, first with that, you know, recognizing, look, we have these challenges, but you know what, we can tackle this. This isn't going to overtake us. We will do better, and because we know we have to. When we look at the fact that, you know, just a couple weeks ago, the report came out saying that Rochester is now fifth in the nation for childhood poverty. And so I don't want to go to being one. You know, I want to be able to, as a community, stand up and say that we are really going to tackle this issue and, you know, build businesses. We're going to attract, you know, companies here to employ our residents so that we can make sure that our children are educated. So it's a lot of work to do, but it's up from here. So it's really about believing in ourselves as a community so that we can accomplish that.
And you said that Rochester is a tale of two cities, and you called one city vibrant, hopeful, wealthy, highly livable, and then you said the other city suffers from escalating poverty, dysfunction, unemployment, and a deficient educational system. And, you know, where is a realistic place for you to start tackling that divide here in Rochester?
You just have to start. I believe that all three go hand in hand. When you are undereducated, your access to a good quality job diminishes. You are most likely to look at crime as an option for you. And so all three feed off one another. And so you just really have to start tackling and working on all three at the same time. I think that I brought a good team into City Hall that are committed to tackling those issues, and we will, you know, do that holistically. One doesn't supersede the other. You know, we have time to really build on our assets, and I think that we have a lot of assets here. When you look at the city that we talk about, that's vibrant, that's moving forward, how do we trickle that into the other part of Rochester? How do we start to uplift that part of Rochester? That's going to be the challenge, and but I believe that the team that we built is committed to doing that and will do that.
Your colleague downstate, Bill de Blasio, he's also used that same sentiment, a tale of two cities, when looking at New York, New York City in particular. And he's seeking to raise taxes, among other things, to help with this divide between the rich and the poor. And some politicians, they call his agenda very progressive. They say he's going to have a lot to deal with Governor Cuomo and the legislature to get some of his ideas approved. And I wanted to know, do you share a similar progressive outlook or vision for Rochester?
Well, yes. You know, I think that progressive, but not necessarily when it comes down to taxes. Now, I think that we can do a lot with what we have currently. We need to start looking at what we're funding. Are we really getting our bang for our buck? When you look at the fact that Rochester's United Way raises more money than basically Buffalo, Syracuse, and Albany combined, that means that this little city here, little region here, has been throwing a lot of money at this problem. You look at foundations like the Ferris Foundation, Daisy Marquis Jones, they throw a lot of money and give a lot of money to try to solve this problem. Where are we missing the mark? And that takes all of us sitting down at the table and saying, this is what we're giving money towards. This is where it's improving. This is where we're not having any gains at all, and it's going down. And should we rethink what we're doing? A lot of times, taking a step back from the table and going back is a good thing. And for me, that's going to be the challenge, is getting people to start thinking differently about where we're putting money. One of the things that I have spoken about and spoken to businesses about, especially people in our manufacturing businesses, we need to start training people for a job. We don't do that. We do blanket training, workforce development training, and that is not really meeting the mark when it comes to unemployment. We need to sit down with our small businesses and say, what are the skills that you need? And if we give and prepare this particular person for that job, will you hire them? And that's a different type of thinking. I have already sat down with Dr. Kress and talked about that from MCC, and we're going to start preparing to do that.
And you said you have a progressive vision, but not necessarily, you mentioned, with taxes. So are you not planning to raise, is raising taxes a reality? Is it something that you would consider?
Well, we just got to the seat, so I know that, even if we raised taxes 2%, that would only give us, $3 to $4 million. That's not gonna solve our issues. We have a $26 million budget deficit at this point in time. So that's not gonna solve our challenges as it pertains to the city's budget. But what we can do is look at our priorities. We want to make sure that we are maintaining our essential services and our customer service relations are great. But we also know that we have to start dealing with these social issues and social challenges that feed into this perception of what's happening in our city. And that's going to take more than just the city. It's going to take our partners in the county, as well as our partners across the government and not-for-profit world as well. And being progressive is actually bringing those people to the table and saying, look, this is the way we've done it in the past, and this is the way we're going to do it in the future.
And you mentioned partners in the county in particular. County Executive Maggie Brooks, she backed you in the mayoral race. I want to know, how do you envision, what's your plan in terms of that partnership between the city and the county to make some of these issues, these challenges, these ideas work?
Well, when you brought up Mayor de Blasio, and, in New York City, you have a completely different dynamic because everyone, the five boroughs, you may have some poor boroughs, but they all represent New York City. And what we have here is that our more affluent people live in a certain portion of the city, but most of them live out in the suburbs. So you need to make those connections with the county executive and let everyone know, so goes the city, so goes the rest of the county. And so we're in this together. It's not an us versus them thing. This is a we.
You tell me a little bit, what do you hope could come out of a strong relationship between the city and the county? I mean, that would be different than from the past.
Well, I think that the county handles a lot of the social services. And so when you look at the way in which the county deals with people that are on social services, families, children and families, the county also, as you know, house our people that are being arraigned for jails. They also control our workforce development board. And so those are all programs that predominantly affect the city, but are controlled by the county. And so having a relationship with the county exec and being able to work with them is going to be imperative to trying to deal with the social issues that are plaguing our community.
I want to talk a little bit about education, and you've called the educational crisis in Rochester, the high dropout rates, the low graduation rates, you've called it our Hurricane Katrina and our Hurricane Sandy. You said that the situation is that damaging, and as a mayor, you really want to step up and do more than a role traditionally played by a mayor when it comes to education. And I've talked with you before on Need to Know Rochester about the Warren Education Plan. So tell me, now that you're mayor, what, and with this particular plan, what do you see yourself implementing head on right away?
Well, definitely we'll be working on instituting the Office of Education Innovation. That's the first thing that we're going to do, opening up the doors to charter schools with proven success rate in urban education is something that we're going to go after. Also working with the school district and partnering, seeing which ways that we can utilize the resources that we currently have on the table a lot better is something that we are doing. And also our recreation centers. We know that in the summertime, we at our recreation centers sometimes get 300 to 400 kids a day. How can we make that an opportunity so that children are not losing that reading and those math skills over the summer? How can we have more organized sort of recreation? Those are the things that we have to think about. One of the other, the big things, and I learned this when I visited Washington with the president, is there's a lot of money that's out there for grants and funding, and hiring a grant writer that is permanently focused on going out there and really accessing dollars and getting grants to for our social issues and social programs is something that we have to do. We cannot just, we don't have the tax base to do it ourselves, but once we have the resources, making sure that we're utilizing the funds in a way that actually uplifts our children is essential to moving our community forward.
You mentioned charter schools, and there's, and speaking of Hurricane Katrina, they say that charter schools are, they call it the post-Katrina success story, given the fact that after Katrina, the city of New Orleans handed over a majority of the public school system to the Recovery School District, and this is a district within the state that works to improve schools that are low performing. And they in turn let charter school operators come in and take over a majority of the schools. And that being said, now New Orleans, their graduation rate is higher there than throughout the rest of Louisiana. And so when it comes to charter schools, what besides being another option for families, and besides that serving, being a tool, so to speak, to not get families to opt out and move to the suburbs or private schools, how do you think they can better serve kids that live within Rochester?
Because they understand urban education in a different way, and they don't have the system that's the barrier to providing education to our children. It's about opportunity, access to opportunity. At the end of the day, we want all of our children to be given the opportunity to succeed. What does that look like? If you walk into a school today, and I walk into my daughter's school, and you look at her class, and the first thought through your mind should not be which one of these children succeed, or half of them will succeed and half of them will fail. That shouldn't be what goes through most people's mind when they walk into a classroom in our city schools today. It should be that all of these children will have the opportunity to succeed because we're going to give it to them. Because we're going to give them the exposure, we're going to give them the opportunity, we're going to have a system in place that uplifts them regardless of what's happening in the outside world. Now we have work to do on our city streets as it pertains to our neighborhoods and crime, and parents have work to do. But this is about not pointing the finger at one another and saying, this is your problem, this is your fault, but we know that there's a problem, now let's do the work. Let's change things for the better so that our children have the opportunity to succeed.
When it comes to charter schools, we know that not all are successful. So, as mayor, how will you balance, the city's time and resources between charter schools and the city school district?
Well, you know, the city has to give $119.1 million to the city school district, and that's not going to change. That's something that's mandated by the state. And we wouldn't give money necessarily to charter schools directly because we can't do that. They would get their, you know, charter schools are public schools. They're not a, you know, private school. They're public schools. And so what we will do is open the door and say to those charter schools that have a proven success rate in urban education, what do you need to come here and let us help you get that? Rather that's a building, rather, you know, if it's access to parents that, you know, are looking for educational opportunities, let's talk about ways in which you can come and help us make our city schools better and make our city better for our children that live here.
I'm going to transition just a little bit to your team, to your new team. And I want to know, you know, what were you looking for when assembling your team?
Looking for people that understood that this was not about the past, but about the future. This is not about where we've been, but about where we're going. And people that are forward thinking, that think outside the box, that don't, you know, when you talk to them, say, well, you know, we've always done it this way. And it's not that you throw out the old with, you know, or the baby with the bathwater, because that's not what I did. I kept some people from the Duffy and the Richards administration. And that's because, you know, you can build a team around a common vision. And I think that the people that I chose to retain and the people that I brought on board are those people that are excellent and you know, forward thinking in their own right, experts in their field, and have had a success rate, a success record. And I am confident that they will lead the city where it needs to go.
You mentioned the partnership between the city and the county, and I'm curious to know, is city residency, is that a prerequisite in terms of selecting your team?
Well, that is, it's not, they will have to move into the city. So they don't have to currently live in the city, but they get a year to move into the city. But majority of them already live in the city.
And you decided to add two positions that were eliminated under Bob Duffy and Tom Richards. It's the chief of staff and the special projects director. Why the decision to bring those back? And what do you envision, what role do you see those playing within the city, those positions?
Well, the chief of staff will manage and work with our staff, be a liaison to myself and a deputy mayor, also to the community. But the director of special projects will be focused on making sure that we build the Office of Education Innovation, that we look at ways in which we can partner with our businesses and be that person out there that's building up those special projects that we're gonna have to work on. We'll most likely be working directly with the person that's going after those national grants that are out there that we've not really had someone focus on that, and look at where we need to go as a city and carry forth those duties.
And we talked a lot about education in terms of the Office of Education Innovation. Is the lead on that, will that be the special projects director, or have you yet to assign someone to lead that position?
No, I have not set someone to actually lead that position. The Office of the special projects director will be working on making sure that we put everything in place to make that office successful. We'll look at all the plans that I've put out on my website, you know, rather it's my economic development plan, my crime plan, and my education plan, to say, you know, what's realistically something that we can do in year one? What can we do in year two? And how do we do this? And, you know, Alan Williams has a background in finance, so that's very important to me. Special projects director. And so he'll be able to work with our budget director to say, this is how much it's going to cost, this is where we need to access some dollars, working with the grant writer, and setting forth the path forward, with, of course, working hand in hand with me to make sure that we do that.
In terms of your plan for crime, you tried to recruit Chief of Police of DeKalb County, Georgia, Cedric Alexander, back to Rochester. Because of salary, he opted to stay in his current position. And now we've got this national search taking place for the new Chief of Police. You know, who is the ideal person for this job?
Well, I think it's just someone that understands the challenges that Rochester faces. When you have a high concentration of poverty, when you know the area where you have to tackle, what are those national sort of methods for doing that? How will you go about doing it? And it's not just about being punitive, but how can we actually be proactive about some of this stuff that's happening? You know, I think that Chief Shepherd was very, very good at, you know, trying to build those community relations and working and reaching out to the community. But because of the fact that, you know, we weren't shutting down the open air drug markets and we weren't going after our drug dealers and other people that were out here on the corners, it sort of was, you know, a catch 22, or you were between a rock and a hard place. When I'm talking to neighbors and they're like, well, why, you know, are these people still out on a corner? And I've called repeatedly, but you know, the chief shows up at a community meeting, and you know, we talk about it, but what are we actually doing about it? I think that we have to be aggressive about our policing strategies and find a way to balance those policing strategies with community relations.
And when the dust settles and the new chief is in place, what changes can Rochester residents and visitors expect to notice?
Well, I think that we want a cleaner city. We want to make sure that we are that we're not making it okay and comfortable for you to do unsavory activity on our streets. Are we going to stop crime 100%? No. It's unrealistic to say that. Will you have people hanging out on corners? You know, it's unrealistic to say that there will be no one in these areas. But will we make it difficult? Absolutely. When you know, back in March, of last year, when you know, we knew that there was going to be some issues on the corner of Chalai Avenue, we called for, as council members, to have more aggressive policing strategy in that area, and that didn't happen. And you saw over the year, many of the shootings and other activity happen right in that area. And we have to be willing to go after aggressively those people that are causing these problems and make it difficult for them to do business.
You know, the work that we've discussed, you've talked about, it takes time to implement these things and to see change. And how will you determine success in terms of tackling these priority areas of crime, education, you know, economic development, after about a year as mayor?
It's what I hear from the community. They'll tell me whether I'm successful or not. They'll tell me whether they see things changing. And, you know, we'll keep working at it. Of course, it's not going to be something that we're going to be able to do overnight, but it's something that we're definitely committed to doing. We will leave this city better than the way we found it.
And that's it for this edition of Need to Know Rochester. I'm Helen B. and Duty Hofer. Thanks for joining us, and thank you for supporting news and public affairs programming on WXXI. We'll see you next Thursday night at 8 o'clock right here on WXXI TV.